Having ADHD affects my home life in a big way. Being a father, being a husband, my ability to be organized or my ability to plan is, you know.
It's a combination of things. It's a combination of poor concentration, that's the attention side, and it's a problem of control in other ways as well, because the children tend to be very impulsive. They do the first thing that comes into their head. That can make them hard to control, and it can make them overactive. So it's that combination of poor control of attention and poor impulse control and overactivity. That's what defines ADHD.
Somebody with ADHD, for me, has a handful of pebbles, so this is how my brain works. You throw all of them into the pond. So there's then 100 opportunities and 100 thoughts to build on.
One minute I can be very like hyperactive and all over the place and interrupting myself. And then the next minute I can be like in my own bubble, but I'm like thinking of so many different things in my head.
As a child, it is a very isolated thing in society. So you can become alienated from your peers because you're misunderstood. People don't know you, and you can't communicate yourself properly to them.
When my first child was born, he was difficult, but I just thought, well, it's just a baby. And as he started to get older, he was just your typical child that just didn't sleep, that cried a lot, that was very active. At first, I thought I was a bad parent, and you know, as he got older, everybody told me I was a bad parent. Even my own parents told me I was a bad parent.
People say it is due to parents not being able to educate or their own children. They still think that ADHD is really a kid's thing, that people grow over. And it's not a problem in adults.
The ability to manage my emotions is just, it's fallen flat by the time, you know, if I've gone through a particularly, you know, demanding day.
Another very important part of ADHD are emotional symptoms. And not everyone realizes that that's a really another core part of ADHD. And if you talk to most adults with ADHD, they describe getting irritable, frustrated, and angry kind of much more easily than other people.
Wherever you look, there's differences. If you look at the symptoms of patients, that all of them have a diagnosis of ADHD, but if you look at the patients, none of them are the same.
The other important thing to remember is that ADHD is a dimensional trait. So in a way, you can have people with milder levels of ADHD and other people who have much more severe problems. But we also see a lot of people who were misdiagnosed. And in fact, in our adult clinic, about 80% were not diagnosed in childhood.
For me, it was a relief to be diagnosed. I've gone through the majority of my life not knowing I had ADHD. And, you know, as a consequence, I've been very hard on myself.
I was told that I have ADHD, dyslexia and dyspraxia, and that came as a surprise for me. And like most people, I knew nothing about ADHD and I wanted to know more.
Critics will definitely say that we're overdiagnosing ADHD, but in some groups we're still not good. As I said, it's the adults in particular, and if you look at gender, it is mainly the boys who are getting diagnosed, because in females ADHD just looks a little bit different. What everybody is looking for is really a treatment that works and that may cure patients. So what we have right now are, for example, drugs that suppress the symptoms of ADHD. We don't have anything that really cures patients.
Medication is like amazing. It's amazing because it's helped to get my emotions more in control as well, because I used to be all over the place with my moods and things.
The medication has been really tremendous. I mean, for many adults, having medication, you know, can make a huge difference to them. You know, they can be focused, less restless, calmer. You can have a real impact. But there are other people where the main use of medication is to enable them to function. And they may actually like when they're not working, for example, they may be quite happy not to be on treatment.
Medication was something that I wasn't a big fan of it when I was a teenager, because I felt like it made me boring.
If I just take little breaks throughout the day where I do breathing exercises, where I'm just focusing on my breath, which I know is called mindfulness, and it's nothing revolutionary, but will stop me then getting to the end of the day where I'm a wreck.
You need to be open-minded about it. So consider medication, but also consider that doesn't mean neglect other forms of treatment. So for myself, I medicate myself daily and I also meditate.
The drugs will be the most powerful way of modifying the core, of actually modifying the ability to concentrate and focus and hold yourself back. The psychological treatments will be much more about how, given that you've got a problem in that, how you get round it, how you understand yourself, how you control yourself, how you understand the impact you have on other people and allow for that, and how you can talk to yourself in different situations and instruct yourself about what to do.
Whether non-pharmacological treatments work on their own or whether they need to be combined with other treatments, I think it really depends on the person as well, that for some individuals, some children, one treatment may be sufficient and other people will need a combination. And this is also one very important factor in research, that at the moment we conduct a lot of randomized controlled trials, so these really use a racehorse approach, looking at is one treatment better than the other. But what we actually do see is that there's a lot of variability in treatment response, so that one treatment may work for one child, but another treatment might also work for another child. And I think we really need to do more research into that as well. What predicts who will respond to which treatment?
You have to work together. You have to share data to be able to make progress. And this this understanding is taking hold, and that makes that we are getting the means to work together in larger consortia, because they give us the possibility to look from different angles at the disorder and bring together this knowledge.
For me, in the last few years, being president of ADHD Europe, I think it was the first time that I'd really kind of understood the scientific community and getting involved with them, and I think it's a huge step forward. And through the funding through the European Commission and these wonderful consortiums, we're now working with them. And it's so important that scientists talk to patients. The most important thing for us is to have that evidence and that knowledge that allows us to challenge people who say ADHD doesn't exist.
And this is something that we're trying to exploit in these consortia that we run more and more. So patient organizations helping us, for example, recruiting patients, but also really designing the research. What is the most important question that we should answer?
One thing that I think is very important to focus on in research is to move away from this deficit-based model that we have of ADHD towards a more strengths-based model. And this involves moving away from a view that disproportionately emphasizes the deficits in the individuals with ADHD to a more balanced view that also highlights the strengths that these individuals have.
There are various artistic traditions where wandering and mind wandering are actively advocated and pursued. So what's interesting is that when you come to the world of psychiatry, the narrative is slightly different, and I want to know why it is that a brain like mine is considered as a disorder.
It just like brings out creativity, I think. That's how I see it. It brings out like my creativity and it makes me feel like really happy.
I definitely keep the spontaneous ability, the ability to improvise on the spot. I'd keep hold of the hyperactivity, my excess energy levels. The things I wouldn't keep are the forgetfulness, the disorganisation, my inability to communicate my thoughts. I feel like a universe stuffed within a shoebox.
We should not be, you know, constantly telling people that, oh, people with ADHD end up in the prison system. They do end up in the prison system, but it's usually those who don't get that early help and that support.
It's important to spread the awareness, first of all, so that children can be recognised early and people can understand that they're not behaving like that because they want to or because they're naughty, it's because they can't do anything else. So understanding the nature of the problem is going to reduce stigma, it's going to reduce blame, and it's going to reduce self-stigma and self-blame.
I think it is important to train the teachers to detect the symptoms and also
teach them skills in terms of how to handle ADHD.
Employers need to understand it better. There are simple things you could do at work to have a quiet environment, to find out the optimum way that somebody functions and facilitate them within the workplace.
I mean, there's enormous scope to find a way forward, but I think at the root of it all is education.
For me at least, it's the thing that stops me from really being open about my ADHD, because there is an awareness of ADHD, but the awareness is, for me, it's a lot of misconceptions.
To have a diagnosis of ADHD doesn't mean that you're going to have a bad life. It could mean, with the right help, that you have the most fantastic life. You know, because they are great kids, they're stimulating, they're interesting, and they're intelligent.
I think the future for ADHD treatment, if people are able to get the balance between drugs and things such as mindfulness or exercise, we stand a good chance of having a bright future.